Do contracts intimidate you? If so, you're going to want to listen to this video because I have guest Lisa Fraley, who's a legal coach and an attorney on, and she's going to discuss the five must-haves that every contract or simple agreement should have. And this is going to help you protect your income and your business. So keep watching. For the best information on how to grow your online business, you got to subscribe to my channel. Hit the bell below and you're going to get notified every Tuesday when I release new videos. If you've ever wondered if your current agreement's good enough, or maybe you're brand new to coaching and you're saying, Margie, I don't even know what to have a client sign. Don't worry, I got your back. Lisa Fraley is going to break down the quick and dirty of what all coaching contracts should have so that you're protected as well as your client. So Lisa, I know that there's a lot of entrepreneurs out there and they're really confused about even just the difference between, or is there a difference between contracts and agreements? Let's clear that up first.
That's a great question, Margie, because I think people really do get confused over which is which and when to use which term. And actually, contracts and agreements are the same thing. And what they usually mean is that two parties or more, but just let's say in the case of a coach and a client, you've actually come together, you've had a meeting of the minds, as we like to say in law, you've come together where one person's providing services and the other person's providing payment, and you agree on the terms of this relationship and have something being exchanged between you. And when you do that, you both want to sign the document at the bottom to show that you actually both agree to the terms of the contract, also called an agreement.
Awesome. So really those terms are interchangeable, and answer this for me, because I think a lot of people want to know this. If you've not had an attorney write up a contract and you just create what I think most people are used to as like a simple service agreement,
right.
As long as both people signed it, it's still legally a contract, correct?
Yeah, so here's the thing. Technically, yes, it is a contract, because all that a contract requires, and this is the legal terminology, is an offer, acceptance, and consideration, which consideration means that you're exchanging something for something else, basically. One person's doing one thing and someone else is doing another thing, and that's why you're actually coming together to contract in the first place. And as I always point to my lighted ampersand marquee on the wall, and just like with anything, just because you can create it yourself doesn't mean you always should create it yourself. Mm-hmm. The reason for that is because I know a lot of people just want a simple coaching agreement. They just want it to be super simple. They want it to be easy to understand. They don't want it to be complicated or long because they're afraid a client isn't going to sign it. And at the same time, I'm all for that. All of my legal documents are written in plain English that are easy to understand, but you also want to make sure you have the right language in it to actually protect you. Because otherwise you can have a client agreement that you both have signed and you both are agreeing to do things, but the language in it doesn't get specific enough or doesn't spell out enough what each of you is going to do or not do in a way that makes it hard to enforce. And that's the whole goal, is that you want it to be clear and understandable for both of you, but you also want it to protect your interests and be fair and reasonable for your client as well. So if you're just creating it on your own, you might not know what you're missing. I like to say you might be leaving holes the size of Swiss cheese, because you might be missing parts that you as a lawyer just don't know should be in the document.
That makes total sense. And I think that clarifies for a lot of people why it's important to have legal assistance. So Lisa, I know that sometimes attorneys can be intimidating. So for the normal person to go to an attorney, it's kind of intimidating. And
of course,
at my financial firm, I worked with a lot of attorneys through estate planning and business contracts and all sorts of things. So for me, I knew the people that I could like go to, that I could have a real conversation with. So I've always kind of told people, you know, find an attorney that you can actually talk to and have a conversation. But what would you give our viewers advice on as far as how to pick the right attorney?
Yeah, and I think it's totally normal to be afraid of lawyers or uncomfortable with the law or uncomfortable with lawyers. A lot of lawyers are, you know, come from the adversarial side of the system, so they're trained to be fighting for you. That's a lot of the approach. It's a very masculine approach. Not that there's anything wrong with that. But I do always try to infuse some love and some spirituality and some energy into the law to make it a more relaxed and calm way to protect yourself and your business. It doesn't have to be scary and it doesn't have to be overwhelming. And in fact, it's funny, Margie, because even like you who owned your own financial services firm, I work with a lot of really high achieving and motivated women, some men as well, but many women who are highly accomplished and very bright and capable. But like all of us, when we get outside of our own area of expertise, we feel like we're speaking Greek. Like we don't even, and I remember the first time I went to my accountant, I was like, yeah, I'm like a reasonably bright person, but I don't even know what to ask you. I don't even know what you need. I have no idea what to give you. So can you just like talk to me and tell me what I need to do? And that's how a lot of people approach me as well. And that's totally fine. You should have a lawyer who's comfortable with you saying, hi, I feel kind of, I don't know what I'm supposed to do. Can you help me? And that's the lawyer's job, is to say, yes, of course, it's no problem. Don't worry. We'll help you figure out what you need to do so that you can protect yourself and your business and your brand and your website and your income and your contracts, right? That's the job of the lawyer. So when you're looking for a lawyer, there are several things that you can look for. One, as you said, is someone that you feel comfortable that you can talk to, obviously. The second is you always want to make sure you work with a lawyer who actually understands the nature of your business. A lot of people don't realize lawyers have specialties like doctors have specialties. Right, we all sort of know that doctors have different medical specialties, but lawyers actually have specialties as well. So you want to work with a lawyer who understands small business. And if you're a coach, you want to work with a lawyer who understands coaches. There are not a lot of us out there, but I am a coach, as you shared, as well as a lawyer. So I get coaches, but you want to make sure you're working with someone who understands the subject matter of what your business is about. And then finally,
excellent advice. That's really smart advice.
Yeah, and you want to be clear about how they work, right? How they communicate with you, how often they communicate with you, what their payment structure is, how you can get a hold of them if you have a question. You want to just get really, they should be very open with you about all of their policies around client communication and payment.
Totally agree. I think that's awesome advice. So let's change tunes for a minute here. So I want to talk to our viewers about five areas that really every contract should have, or agreement, whatever you want to call it. And I know we've talked about what these five areas are, but I'm going to turn it over to you. And I'd really like you maybe to start off with payment terms and what we need to know about with payment terms when we're looking at a contract or an agreement.
Yes, exactly. So we're talking about like a simple coaching agreement, right? Just for sake of our example, we're talking about if you're a coach and you want to work one-on-one with a client, these are terms that you want to have in your agreement, because each contract will be slightly different if you're doing a group program or an online course, or you're hiring an independent contractor or someone to work for you as a VA. Like, contracts all have some similar language, but they also vary. You can't just, one client contract, as I like to say, does not fit all. Just like one diet does not fit all, right? So you want to make sure you're using the right contract for what you're doing. So we'll talk for now about the example of being a coach working with a one-on-one client. So one of the things, as you just alluded to, is that it's so important to be clear about payment. And when it comes to payment, there's several aspects of this that you want to make sure you're clear about. First and foremost, that we all think about, is how much is your program, right? What is the investment for the program or the service that you're providing?
That seems like just a little detail.
It's a little detail. You would be surprised, Margie, how many people forget to put that in their contract.
Wow, okay.
Or they don't want to put it in their contract because they think, well, what if I want to change it later, then I have to change the contract. But you really want to have that number in the document so that you can be very clear about what you're agreeing to give and the exact amount they're agreeing to pay. Because if they don't pay that, it's harder for you to prove that they agreed to pay that amount, right? Unless it's in the contract that you both sign. So payment, how much the total investment is. You also want to break down, a lot of coaches will offer payment plans, right? Installment payments. So instead of pay, you want to specify what the amount is that they pay in full, and when they need to pay in full by, the date of enrollment, prior to the first day of the course, whatever. Or do you accept installment payments, 10 payments of X, 2 payments of Y, whatever it is, and when those payments are due specifically. That's really important. And then you also want to be clear about whether or not you take a deposit. Some coaches will require a deposit to be made right away, and then we'll start the investment and the payment installments later. So you be very, very clear in your document about all of this. You also want to be clear about what your refund policy is. right? What if someone decides to drop out halfway through the course? Do you give them a full refund and give them all their money back that they paid so far? Do you give them part of their money back? Like maybe they've been in the course halfway, so you keep money for the first half of the calls they've had with you, but they're dropping out, so maybe you refund the second half that they aren't going to have with you. That's an option. Or some people give no refunds at all and say, anytime you sign up for this course, please be aware I do not give any refunds for any reason. And there's no one right or wrong refund policy. There's no one right way or wrong way to do it. It just has to feel aligned with you energetically. And you just need to have it in writing, very clear of what that policy is. Okay. Awesome. So payment policy.
So then, Lisa, once you get clear in the contract about payments, what about the responsibilities? So as you stated earlier, each side, party has certain things that they're agreeing to. So
that's
what
right.
Look like.
That's right. So when you're working as a coach, you're going to be providing services to your client. So what are the services? What are the responsibilities? What are the things you're going to provide to your client in your program? So for example, let's say you have a program that's 6 calls in 3 months, and you're also going to be giving PDFs, and you're going to be giving videos and maybe bonus calls or a bonus gift basket or something like that. You would want to spell all of that out in terms of what their program description includes. And also, you know, for the calls, are they 60 minutes, 45 minutes, are they by phone, Skype, Zoom? Like, be very specific about how you're going to deliver your services. The more specific, the better. Why? Because it's, if you do provide them, or if they say that you don't, it's easier to prove, yes, I gave, you know, 6 60-minute calls by Zoom throughout the course of the program, rather than getting confused about them think you think you're giving a 45-minute call and they think, oh no, I have an hour with her. Like, you need to be very clear. It's your responsibility as a coach to spell that out. So responsibilities are really important. Who's responsible for what? So the coach is responsible for providing the services and spelling them out. And then you want to tell the client what they're responsible for. Are they responsible for coming to the calls on time? Are they responsible for coming without distraction? Some coaches have clients do homework or journal entries or things in between calls, and they have to turn them in and be reviewed beforehand. What are the responsibilities of the client in terms of how they show up for themselves in the call? So spelling all these expectations and duties and responsibilities out makes it cleaner and clearer. And the whole goal of this contract is to create clarity between you. When you're more clear, the other person shows up and gives better results, they end up happier, you receive a better testimonial, and everyone is happy with the program. That's the goal.
And that's what we want, happy clients, right?
Yes, exactly. That's right.
So Lisa, what about like termination or get out clauses? Does every contract have to have it? If they do have it, what does that look like?
That's a great question. And you know what? That comes right after what we were just talking about, right? Because ideally, you're attracting these beautiful, wonderful clients who you're a great match for. You've already done a discovery call or talked to them or screened them, or they applied to work with you or whatever. So you kind of already know, but sometimes there are those occasions where it just isn't a good fit anymore, or circumstances have changed and they need to drop out of the program, or you decide they're not a good fit for you anymore. So you always want your contract to have what we call termination clause. And I know that sounds like such a harsh word, like I'm terminating you from the program, but it's just a legal term to mean like we're stopping, we're terminating our work together. Don't make it scarier than it is, but it is called the termination clause. And what you want to do is actually say the situation for both of you. So what happens if you decide they're not a good fit and you want to terminate them from the program, right? Do they get any of their money back? Do they get lose immediate access to the program? Like, what happens? And if you decide that you don't want to work with them anymore, a lot of coaches will say, well, if it's my decision and we have 3 sessions left, I'll give them their money back for those sessions that we're not having, because it's my decision to not work with them anymore. It feels weird to keep their money when they don't have a say in whether or not we're going to continue, right? But on the flip side, if the client decides that they're withdrawing or they're dropping out or they want to terminate or they have to stop doing the work, then some coaches will say, you know what, I held this space for you, so there isn't a refund if you decide to drop out, because I held the space that someone else could have filled. Or some coaches will give them some of their money back. It just really depends. But the goal is to be really clear, right, Margie, about what happens when we stop working together and how do we notify each other? Do you email me? I recommend email over calling, but where do you email? When do you email? Who do you email? What's the email address? Make sure you're very clear about how notice, it's called notice, is given for termination from working together in the agreement.
Awesome. Thank you for clarifying that, because I think that's a big one. And I think you keep mentioning the word clear, which I love, because everything I talk to about entrepreneurs is about being clear, right? If you're going to have freedom in your life, you got to be clear on what that looks like. If you're going to have a business, you need to be clear on all aspects, your marketing, your technology, you know, your income streams. So this is just another area where you really need to have that clarity. So one, I think we need to tell our viewers that you need to be careful about what you say and who you say it to. Do you currently have a coaching contract for your clients, or do you not have one? Let me know by putting it in the comments below. So let's talk about confidentiality, because I know we're in, while the world seems big, the coaching space is
small. Yeah, that's right.
It's very easy to have experiences where all of a sudden you're hearing people talk. And so one, I think we need to tell our viewers that you need to be careful about what you say and who you say it to.
Definitely.
Because the space is small. But yes. So I also know that there should be, and maybe this goes back to my financial advisor days.
Of course, right.
But confidentiality to me is a no-brainer, but for a lot of people it's not. So can you talk about should there be a confidentiality clause?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Okay. So Margie, as you all know, was a financial advisor in her last lifetime. And so she had legal requirements and laws that required that she keep financial information safe for her clients. I'm a lawyer, and so I have laws that say I have to keep information confidential with my clients that we can't disclose them to other people. But as a coach, for example, or a holistic practitioner, or someone who's an online entrepreneur, if you're not a licensed professional with that obligation, you don't have laws that require that you keep information confidential, but just for the integrity of yourself as a business owner, and just for the sake of building trust with your clients, you want them to know that you do keep their information confidential, and that I recommend that you actually not share it with anyone outside of your team members. Like, you might have a virtual assistant working with you or something like that who needs to know or gets into your back end of your online platform or something. That's fine. That's reasonable. They would have a reasonable need to know that information. But you don't want to be telling your friends or talking to your mastermind friends about what's going on in any way that identifies any of your clients, because you just want to keep your professionalism and keep yourself in integrity that your clients feel safe to talk to you. So like in all of my do-it-yourself written agreements, like the do-it-yourself client agreement, there's a section called confidentiality, which spells out that you'll keep their information safe and confidential and won't disclose it unless you're required to in certain circumstances, like by law, or you're compelled by the court, or within reason to members of your team and things like that. But I don't agree, just it's so important just to keep that information safe so your clients really do feel like they can show up and share their deepest worries and concerns and goals, and that you'll keep that sacred for them.
And not to go off on a tangent here, but it's also a smart idea to have confidentiality agreements between yourself and your VAs, or if you don't know what that is, it's a virtual assistant, or other team members that you may be working
with. That's right.
So the
You know, and that is usually included in your independent contractor agreement, your services agreement. When you're working with that person, you are contracting with them to provide some services to you. It's usually in there, and I know in my DIY independent contractor agreement, it's in there for that very reason, because you also don't want your virtual assistant to run off and tell everyone about your client situation or financial information or credit card or whatever. So yeah, good point. Thank you for sharing that. That was a great ad.
So there's contracts between you and your clients, but there's contracts between you and your team.
Yes. There's all kinds of contracts, actually.
And it's called being professional.
Right, exactly.
It's called being professional and
that's right. The
business, right?
Yes, and protecting the relationship with your clients or with your team or whoever, because you really want them to feel safe to show up for you. So that again, the more they really share with you what's going on, the more you can really help them, the more better results they can really get, and the more their life will really improve, which is your goal of coming from a place of service to begin with. And the more they'll also tell everyone how wonderful it was to work with you, which is great too. So it's win-win-win-win-win all around.
Awesome. Lisa, there's another thing I want to talk about, and I want to talk about disclaimers.
Yeah. So
what exactly are disclaimers? Why do we need them? Where do we need them?
Exactly.
Break it down for us if you would.
So disclaimers in general is language that legally is disclaiming your liability, which means that you're spelling out for people where your liability ends as the coach and where their liability begins as the client. And so in your client agreement, there should be sections devoted to disclaimers saying, for example, if you're a life coach, let's say, you would want to say, I am not acting as a doctor or a medical licensed medical professional or a therapist or a clergy member or a lawyer or an accountant or financial advisor. Like, I am not doing any of those things. I'm here as your coach to help support you, but you still need to go see your own doctors, your own medical providers, your own lawyer, your own accountant, your own financial, like all of the people, so that you are not putting yourself at risk at them thinking that you're giving them medical advice or financial advice or legal advice or whatever advice. And also so they're really clear by you saying, hey, I'm here to show up in a place of service for you, to support you as your mentor and your guide, but you are responsible for your results, for the decisions and actions that you take going forward. I'm here to guide you and give you information and education and support, but you take that information and go forward and make decisions for your own life. Because as we know, the role of a coach is to basically help people find the answers within themselves and take actions and make decisions in their own lives or businesses. So that disclaimer, you can have disclaimers for all sorts of things, Margie. I have like a gazillion on my website and my do-it-yourself legal template. But the disclaimer section should be part of your client agreement. It also should be part of what I call your terms of use, which is the document to use for online courses and programs where people check the checkbox when they're entering their credit card and checking out to buy it. So disclaimers can be long, short. You want to have them several places in your business, including your client agreement.
Awesome. So Lisa, before we wrap up, there is one thing that I wanted to just mention to our viewers. So I recently launched a pretty massive digital course. There's like 13 courses that you get.
Fabulous.
Yeah, it was.
I can just see you like, yes, it's amazing. Yes.
But I used your, because you are so versed in the online world with, you know, digital, of course I have my agreements for Freedom Academy. But for my digital courses, I did use your DIY templates. And I have to say, I love the templates. They're super easy. I think your price is like so amazing for what you give. And it's something that every entrepreneur out there can have and use and reuse if needed for new products that they're doing. The one thing that you did tell me to do was to make sure it had my state language on that. Do you just want to touch really quick on state language?
Yeah.
Why that's important?
Yep. And so this will vary. Okay. So basically you want to make sure as a business owner that you've registered your business in your state locally, in your city, sometimes also your county, and sometimes also your state. That's a whole nother conversation for another day, but make sure you've registered your business. Why? Because you want to make sure that you have on record where your business is based. Right? If you have an LLC or an S corporation, it will be the state where that LLC or S corp is registered. But if you're a sole proprietor, a sole practitioner, just starting out, a single coach operating out of your home office, you want to register your business locally. Why? Because in your client agreements and in your legal documents, your terms and other things, you want to make sure that the law that is being followed for the agreement is the law where your state is based, right? Now, this doesn't mean you don't have to follow laws of other states in general, but it means that if there's a conflict—
You can't just disregard the laws of every other state?
You can't. But what you mean, though, is if you're in one state and your client's in another state, you're already saying by virtue, but only because you have this agreement, you're following the laws of your state. But it's gotta be—
Because if something does happen and you do need support, you want—
That's right.
Where you live, you don't have to be traveling and getting hotels and everything else
somewhere else
that person may live.
That's right. Yep, yep. And for some types of coaches, like health coaches, there are certainly nutrition laws that come into play. And so you want to be very clear about registering your business where your business is based, and then of course knowing what your laws allow you to do and not do in your state. You do want to talk with an attorney about your business. You, like we talked about earlier, you want to make sure that you have clarity around that so that you can relax and not have to worry as much, and you can just show up and go out and share your business and your gifts with the world, which is what you're really here to do. So the having a lawyer on your team, and the fact that Margie wanted to share this information with you today, is so important, because the more that you're aware, just like anything, the more you increase your awareness, the more you get energetically aligned, the more you consciously are aware of the choices you're making, and the more that you are creating clarity around your boundaries, your policies, and I believe energetically, the more that you are attracting to you clients who also mirror those boundaries and policies. Maybe not every time, but most often, what you're putting out there is what is coming back to you. So the more you get clear, it's such a gift to yourself and your business to have those policies in writing. Just like you said,
it's a gift to your client too.
Oh, it's totally a gift to your client.
For everybody, because the clarity, you know, around, okay, this is you're saying yes to, and this is what I'm saying yes to, and not having the, oh my gosh, who is right, right? Where does that fall? Whose responsibility is that, you know?
That's right.
Like everything else in your business, the more systems and structure that you can put into place, the easier things run, the more freed up you are to be creative, right? I know a lot of times creatives will say, well, I don't want that because it'll tie me down. And it's like, no, that's what gives you freedom. That's what allows you to be more creative and live in that genius zone, because you don't have to worry about that stuff.
And I'm so glad you said that, because I had a client, Sarah, who's been kind enough to share her story on my website. And she actually is a creative who said that. She said that exactly, Margie. She was like, I'm scared. I don't want to feel boxed in. But do you know what? She actually ended up saying that she felt more grounded and more safe and more clear about her policies, that she actually, just like you said, she felt more free because she already knew where the boundaries were and where the box was and where everyone was playing in the same sandbox with the same rules. Then she felt free to kind of go out and create, rather than worrying, oh, was I clear about that? Oh, that great client wants to cancel, but I don't have anywhere written if they can't make it up, like, or whatever. It just gives you that freedom. And I know freedom is so important to you. That's one of your key core values in your Freedom Academy. And so it does, legal documents do give you freedom. You would never think in a million years that they do, but they really do. They shift how you, they shift how you show up in your business and you show
up. I love that. So thank you. Thank you so much. And I really appreciate it.
Well, thank you so much for inviting me. And thank you so much to Margie for making this an important topic for you to cover for your tribe, because I think that the more that you are helping others show up in their confidence and courage as a business owner, which is what you teach them to help them be free and have a successful business, the more they also are learning how to protect their business. And that's a nice hand that goes along with
totally agree. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Thank you.
All right. Now that you have this information on contracts, it's time to go back and review your contract. Get with your attorney if needed, and if you don't have one, go find one that you can talk to. And if you want to join a society of like-minded entrepreneurs who are all looking to crush it online, then hey, come join my secret society, and I'm going to share all the latest up-to-date information with you. If you like this video, you gotta let me know. And make sure you tell me what other topics you want to know about in the comments below as well. Comment with the word legal if you found this video especially helpful, and like it, share it, and again, make sure you subscribe to my page. Thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you on the next video.